which actually it's an application that demonstrates the applicability of tinyML beyond the audio and video, but also in real world applications, and will be given by Rob Lauer, who's the developer relations lead by Blues Wireless. He will talk about how to do remote birding with TensorFlow Lite and Raspberry Pi. So Rob.
Awesome. Thanks, Theo. Hi, everyone. Thanks for sticking around. So get ready for 4 minutes of some of the more impractical and slightly silly ML you've ever seen. But so as many of us, of course, reach middle age and beyond, we become kind of like this guy, right? We're calling people to come look at the exciting action at the bird feeder. And I thought, well, you know, I've been thinking more about creating a device that could actually do this work for me. So this, of course, became, you know, the most obvious machine learning project ever. However, full disclaimer, in the grand scheme of things, I'm relatively new to ML. And I think I'd been kind of scared into this assumption that inferencing and especially model generation is going to require a lot of CPU resources. I also knew that any hardware deployment would be outside my house, so I'd need to be prepared accordingly. And related to that, I wouldn't have any network access, so relaying data was going to be a bit of a trick for me. Since I didn't then want to experience a hardware bottleneck, I'd started with a heavyweight, a Raspberry Pi single board computer. Suffice to say, a Raspberry Pi was a little bit overkill for this project, kind of overpowered. However, especially when using TensorFlow Lite, you know, my experience, this was really unmatched. I learned how quickly I could put together a fun, albeit slightly impractical project in minimal time with minimal compute power needed. And for this off-grid deployment, I really wanted to pull out the big guns here. So I used a 30,000 milliamp USB-C power bank with pass-through charging. I hooked up a sizable 42 watt solar array. So this Raspberry Pi could function in a nearly sustainable fashion, I'd say, running kind of indirectly on solar power for some time. And since I'd be out of range of Wi-Fi, I went with a Blues Wireless note card to add low power cellular connectivity. Full disclaimer, I work for Blues Wireless, but I truly believe in this product. And to use that tiny 30 millimeter by 35 millimeter note card with a Pi, I added it to a Pi hat we affectionately call Note Carrier Pi. And this ended up being a great solution for this low power project, because when it's idle, the note card sips only about 8 microamps. Now, I wasn't prepared to make a TensorFlow Lite model of birds from scratch. Luckily, TensorFlow Hub, which we all know and love, contains countless free and open models to use. The one I grabbed was a model of birds around the world, which, yes, did kind of burn me in the end, as you'll see. However, the latency in this model for resolving images on low power hardware was pretty incredible. So with all these kind of puzzle pieces in place, what would I end up building? Well, I started with a PIR motion sensor that could detect when a bird showed up at the feeder. This was followed by taking a picture of that bird and then feeding that bird to a TensorFlow Lite, to the TensorFlow Lite runtime using a small app I wrote in Python. Now, if that model returned a probability match of about 70% or greater, I sent that data to our Blues Wireless cloud service called NodeHub.io. This in turn allowed me to securely route that data to Twilio. Now with Twilio, I could generate a text message so I could be alerted literally within seconds when a bird showed up. So far, so good. Now, I don't obviously have time to dig into the code, but I wanted to show off how many lines of Python it took to utilize that TF-Lite runtime in Python, which I thought was pretty awesome. And really, when it was all said and done, I ended up with 118 lines of code for the entire project. And this is a final look at the deployment. So I've got the PIR sensor and camera on the left, ready to monitor birds. I've got the Raspberry Pi and battery in a weatherproof case in the middle. And on the right, a very cropped image of my solar array. So how did it all work, you want to know? Well, as many of us have experienced, you know, with machine learning, 60% of the time, it works every time. I wasn't exactly expecting magic here. However, I did experience some magic when that first text message actually came through. You know, it said a bird was spotted. But if anybody knows what a Gallus gallus is, well, it's actually a tropical bird known as a red jungle fowl. Now, this is not very likely considering I live in Wisconsin here in the States. So what did I learn? Like, what could I do to improve? Well, certainly transitioning to a lower power microcontroller made a lot of sense. And really what I needed was a model that was better optimized for my use case. And I think this is a really important lesson for, you know, especially for new folks who are new to machine learning. It's kind of garbage in, garbage out. You know, the more accurate, the more appropriate the model, the better. So that's it. If you'd like to see a deeper dive, please check out my tutorial on Hackster at bit.ly/pi-bird. Otherwise, shameless plug for my company, blues.io. We do a lot of cellular IoT related products, and you can read all about us there. And finally, shameless plug for me. If you find yourself on Twitter, you can ask me questions there at Rob Lauer. So thank you all very much. Thanks again for sticking around.
Rob, thank you so much. I think it was a very nice ending to the first day of the EMEA Forum, because quite frankly, it shows that even for hobbies or any personal projects, if you want to call them, this is really cool. In fact, one of the attendees just commented, Christian, he said, even if silly or impractical, this one application is absolutely wholesome. And actually, this leads me to one question I had. Of course, you mentioned you live in Wisconsin, but the question is, would this be useful for, or should I say, how many birds were you able to actually construct with the data set? That was, that would be a key question, I guess.
I know. I mean, I was able to identify like a half dozen different birds. I think if I had the appropriate model, it would have been way more accurate. I mean, really, if you think about it, when most folks in your average backyard, you probably only have four or five different birds that show up. So
maybe one. I don't know.
I mean, if my model didn't include 1,000 birds, I probably would have been, way better off.
Well, no, what I was thinking is if it would actually take you a good amount of time to construct
the data sets
to train the models.
Exactly. Well, that's the other trick. You think of the quality of the image that's being taken, and a bird isn't exactly going to pose for you. So you could be taking it at any different angle with any different types of colors and lighting conditions. So there's a lot of variables to worry about. Yeah,
exactly. Well, thank you, Rob. Actually, I would like to acknowledge again our sponsors. The sponsors are the ones that actually made having a free registration for everybody possible, starting by Newton.ai, who is innovating into the automated tinyML domain, who's also our premier sponsor. Next, we have the executive sponsors. We have Arm, which, as you know, builds from both the software and the hardware foundations for tinyML. We have Edge Impulse, who is advocating strongly, as you all know, for tinyML available to all of the developers. And of course, Qualcomm, who is working as, among other perception, reasoning, and action, and edge and cloud devices in various sectors, such as the Internet of Things, automotive, and mobile applications. And Syntiant, who is moving artificial intelligence from the cloud to the edge, which, as you have seen today, it's quite now the trend nowadays. Next, we have our platinum sponsors, Infineon, part of your life, part of tomorrow. We have seen a few of their projects that they work today. We have Reality AI, who is working also in pre-built edge AI sensing modules and tools. Next, we have our gold sponsors. Latent AI is the first one who works on adaptive AI for the intelligent edge. Then we have SenseML, which works on building smart IoT sensor devices from various data. And last but not least, our silver sponsors, EMSA from Israel, GreenWaves, HOTC, Majimop, Quixo, Seed Studio, and of course, ST Microelectronics. I would like to thank everybody that stuck around until now, and I hope to see everybody tomorrow at 4 o'clock Central European Time